And welcome to Off Planet Radio, Off Planet TV. I'm Randy Moggins, and I have a guest with me today who has not been here for a very long time, but we go back quite a way in talking about things both privately and in the interviews that we've done over the years. It's been, I don't know how long since Dana Donlon has been with me, but she's here tonight. She is the creator of the Experiencer social website, Stellarpax.com. And she is an experiencer. She is a person who has a lot of deep experience in the realms beyond everyday life. And she is someone who has gone very deeply into the mysteries of the things that go bump in the night. Dana, welcome to Off Planet Radio, Off Planet TV.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
It's good to, how long has it been?
We always talk privately, but never do a show, so it's time.
I know. And you had to just call me up and say, hey, let's do this. This is what we call a private session. I don't know why we call it that now. It's not private, obviously, because everybody else is going to see it. But it is one-on-one conversations that we just kind of let evolve naturally like a conversation. And you and I talk infrequently, but often enough that we keep up with each other. And I know that you've had the sense, as well as I, that there has been a dramatic ramp up in a lot of events, a lot of things in the paranormal. It's almost cliche to call it the rending of the veil, but it feels like something's being ripped away, and we're getting more and more influx of energy, influx of very strange, very dark paranormal. And humanity is at a crossroad right now. So tell me what you think about that.
Well, I've been listening to all your shows and they're wonderful. And you always do such an amazing job.
Thanks.
Of drawing things out that really need to be said. And a lot of times you end with the truth is within you.
Right.
And I absolutely agree with that. But I also think that we need to add the creativity and the power to that.
Yeah.
Because, you know, control of our souls has been going on for eons and eons. And we have no idea who we are, where we're going, what we're supposed to do, or what we can do, what we're capable of. And I think we need to find what we're actually capable of.
You know, and even beyond that, most people don't even care. They don't care about any of those boundaries. Most of the people on this planet walk around in a very tightly focused day-to-day state of consciousness. Eat, sleep, work, eat, sleep, work, the hamster cycle. And there's just, it's getting better. I'm seeing a lot of people out there that are starting to at least ask questions, and some are even asking good questions. But the survival mode mentality of humanity right now has done nothing but tie shackles to our legs for thousands of years, because we never stop to think about how we wound up here, what we're supposed to do, and how the hell we're going to get out. And get out, by that I mean, how do we exit out of this reality stream that we're in? Because I don't know about you, but most of the people that I'm talking to are going, you know, this feels really artificial. This feels like we're in some kind of, well, the Matrix is kind of the cliche, the, I guess, artificial quantum reality stream. So this is, yeah. You know, one of the unique things that I've been able to have in my life since I started doing the show is talking to people like you. And they're exceptional people because they have exceptional experiences and they have been forced to adapt and have exceptional outlooks on things. It's part of being a survivor, but even beyond that, it's taking the things that go on around us and using them against the very thing that is the predator of our beingness, our souls.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think for myself, I've walked through that dark place, and it's like, what else can be done to me, basically? Yeah. I mean, they can kill me. Oh, well, so I start over again and do the same thing all over again, maybe. Maybe not. Maybe I have the tools to get out this time. But, you know, the control starts, it starts even before we're born, because if you look at all the different mammals on the earth, most other mammals are born being able to function. Look at human babies. I mean, we come out to be programmed. We come out in a state of complete helplessness.
Yep.
And it gives so much more programming time. I mean, when the horse is born, that baby horse can get up and run around within a few hours and function.
Yep.
You know, and pick reality. But, you know, you've got the grocery basket thing where it's like when we have a baby, we put them in a grocery cart and we go up and down the aisles and we just pitch things into the cart, ideas and beliefs without thinking about it. And that baby just absorbs all these things. And it's never looked at again, whether those things are right or wrong or ridiculous or true.
Or consistent.
Probably, yeah.
Probably the biggest thing. I didn't have a terrible life growing up. I mean, my parents weren't cruel. They weren't overtly controlling in the way that many parents are. But what I learned to believe were a series of conflicts in my own personality, especially as I got, well, quite frankly, even as a small child. Just the concept of being hardwired into a reality when at the same time you're having paranormal experiences. I mean, I was having paranormal experiences when I was 3 years old. And by the time I was 5 or 6, I learned not to talk about that shit anymore.
Oh, yeah. We do learn early.
Yeah. And yet at the same time, we feed children all of this fantasy entertainment stuff. And I just did a recording with Emily that we're probably going to release this privately. But one of the things that I pointed out to her was that one of my screen memories was always Peter Pan, which obviously goes into a whole lot of programming things. It goes into flying dreams. There's just a whole basket of things that go on with Peter Pan. But it's what I remember as a marker for certain experiences of things that happened in the night. And we look at Walt Disney and we look at the programming that goes on with Walt Disney. And I mean, Walt Disney is MK Ultra for kids, basically. It is programming at its highest level. So we give children fantasy books to read, and then at some age we tell them, now you have to throw away your creative imagination, you have to forget about all this, and you need to go to school and learn to speak and spell.
Well, yeah, and I think the reason that we show our children, we're trained to show our children all of this fantasy, is so we can say, do you see that? You can't do that.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't do that. That's imaginary.
We'll call that fantasy. So,
yeah, if they ever have the inkling of being able to do that, then the program kicks in of, oh, mother said that was imaginary. So I can't do that. And I call them DOS programs.
Yeah.
They're DOS programs that are put into our brains that teach us what we can and can't do and what we're supposed to believe.
Now we got to tell people what a DOS program is, because most people don't know what that is anymore.
You take care of that.
Okay, that's just, okay, real quick, 30-second explanation. DOS is disk operating system. It's what were on the earliest computers before they gave us Windows and Macintosh and graphical user interfaces on our phones. So it was when you had to type things into a command line in order to make that computer do anything.
Yeah. Well, and I think as we get older, we add all these programs on top of those.
Yes.
And that's, you know, it's like even the social programs. I mean, the apps that we use, all of us, it's like I noticed an app I had when I was driving. Every time somebody would pull in front of me, I would yell, asshole. I mean, that's just an app. It's an automatic program.
Yep.
We have all these apps. I mean, the smartphone uses an app. And we add all these programs over the top. And we never look at those either. We never examine any of it and say, what programs am I running on? And the problem is we can't actually create in this physical reality unless we absolutely believe it. And we've had all these books come out, all this bullshit, you know, you put the car on the front, picture the car on the refrigerator.
Yeah.
And every time you look at it and you say, oh, I'm going to get that car. Well, no, it doesn't work that way, because underneath your programs don't actually, if you actually believed 100% like you believe that you have to breathe, that you could manifest that car, it would be sitting in your driveway. But it's about how much you believe in something. Yeah, I had a really interesting thing happen here at the house. I'm a very neat person. My kitchen is very neat. I know how many dishes I have and they match. And I had some glasses that the kids had used years ago. And these glasses, I had four of them. Four. One day there were six. I asked my husband, I said, you know, there's only the two of us living here. I said, do you know where these glasses came from? And they were the real old kind you can't even buy anymore. He said, no, I don't know how many glasses we have. You know, typical guy. I said, well, we had four, now we have six. And because I believed it was possible, absolutely, the glass numbers keep changing day to day. I never know how many of them I'm going to have. But it's an absolute belief. I believe that that is possible. And I think we have to start looking at our programming and saying, you know, what do I believe is possible? What can I create? What do I want? You were talking on one of your shows, I don't remember which one, about not basically not participating in the political system anymore because you didn't want to give energy and creation to it.
Yes.
And absolutely, that's what we're talking about, is taking control of where our thought energy is going and looking at those programs and learning to create. And there's ritual, which is basically negative creation. We're equipped to do this without ritual. I think ritual is needed for people who are doing nasty things. And I know there are many people who do positive rituals, but they're just tools. In that case, you don't really need them. And it's another false paradigm, basically. But yeah, people need to begin creating this world the way they want it to be.
Going back a minute to what you said about the car with the magnets on the refrigerator, that goes back to The Secret and all of this new age, and it is new age type philosophy that came in. There is a level to that. You can program yourself for better outcomes using things like that. It's clearly a ritual of itself. I mean, the idea of putting the magnet on the refrigerator and then reinforcing the belief, I can get this job, I can have this car, I can marry this beautiful person, all of these material goals that we would set. The problem with that is, in the background processing, the operating system that's running, the disk operating system, it has a lot of rules about this, and it says, well, but in order to have the good job, to get the car, you've got to go to college and get the good job and go through the corporation system, and you have to reach middle management, buy a two-bedroom house in the suburbs, have 1.3 children, and boom, boom, step, 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 step. Because all those clicks are programmed into you by your environment, by your upbringing. They're beliefs that sit in the background processes running. And it's why when you do this type of ritual or programming, and it doesn't matter what it is, it can be ritual or programming for material things. It can be when you need healing. It can be when you need to recover from a certain situation. It doesn't matter. Everything that we've been programmed with from the time we were that helpless little infant has told us there are steps to this. They are linear. You have to follow each step, and you have to do it exactly right, or you can't have the outcome.
And absolutely. You
know, what you're talking about now is basically a quantum leap beyond all of that. And I know, because we've talked about this before, you actually sent me a manuscript for a book you wrote a few years ago that went into a lot of this. And I was struck when I read the book with the fact that on one level, you were not overthinking it. And on the other level, it wasn't overly simplistic. That's actually quite an achievement, because most people want to map. You know, Dana, I do this show. I've done this show now for, this will be the eighth year. And in the time that I've done this show, I get constant emails, a lot of questions. And I love answering questions. I like talking to the listeners. I'm not always real good at it because I lose emails and I forget phone calls. You know that, because I suck at this. But one of the things that I notice is the repeated entry-level questions that people have after all these years, where no matter how much they've listened, no matter how much they've researched, they just can't get to the next step in solving the puzzle. They're stuck in a reality stream that keeps pulling them down like the undertow in a current, in a stream.
Yeah. Well, you know, everything is an energy field. Everything connects everything in energy fields. And that's how the creative process happens. Mm-hmm. And some people have the ability to flip forward and see probable energy fields. Some people, like psychics, can read energy fields. But, you know, the connection, when you put the picture on the fridge, you're making an energy field connection with that car. But you're right. The programming gets in the way of it. I guess my point is that I want people to understand that it's possible for us to actually create matter. I believe that we have created this matrix, whatever you want to call it, where we are. I don't know where we are, but I think we've created it, and we've been harvested, most people believe, for louche, but I think it's more than that. I think it's we're harnessed for our creative ability.
Yeah.
Because if you have a being that can do something so amazing as create reality without technology, that's scary. You need to harness that. I mean, that's what we would do as humans even now. We would say, oh my gosh, this being appeared, and look, they can just blink their eyes and create things. We'd make sure they couldn't do that because that's too frightening. So it's no wonder it's been done to us. But people need to have, at least in the back of their mind, the possibility that we are creative beings and we are creating our surroundings and our habitat, but we're doing so under the controller's programming.
Yes. They've given us a set of rules and we have to continue to follow them. Science reinforces this. The laws of physics. The laws of physics have changed. You know, it's funny because the laws of physics have changed over time. They've changed more rapidly in our lifetime. And they're changing. They're being redefined now almost daily. But you think, for 500 years, we lived in a Newtonian universe. We believed in the fundamental physics that were taught by Sir Isaac Newton. And then in the 20th century, early 20th century, Einstein came in and began to redefine physics based on the theory of relativity. But it was only 20 years, maybe even a little less, until a whole group of physicists went into the quantum realm. And Einstein, in his lifetime, saw some of his own theories discarded because of the concept that we have this quantum universe where things aren't quite so linear and quite so easily explained by things like energy and mass and the standard laws of physics. All of a sudden, we have Heisenberg with the uncertainty principle. A thing is not. And until you observe it, it's in both states. Well, that completely wipes out the Newtonian universe. It's gone. And it nearly wipes out the Einsteinian universe as well. So science was another religion that was given to us as a set of rules that we had to navigate the reality stream by.
Yeah, well, and people are so stuck on those laws. It's like people that are now looking at flat Earth, round Earth. I don't know where the hell I am. I don't know. None of it makes any sense.
Nobody else does either. That's the beautiful thing about this. Now, we've talked about this on the show quite a bit, and I have my own theories about that. And it's not flat or round Earth. I like what Tesla said. He said it's a realm, and that opens up, because it was Tesla who was a creator, that opens up a potential for something. That opens up a space for creation, which was what Tesla was really about. So I'm sticking with the realm and what it looks like. When NASA finally produces pictures of the Earth from space or vice versa, then we'll talk again about how credible NASA is. But for now, I have to take on faith that the world that I walk on is somewhat flat, but it also appears to have some sort of hemispheric aspect to it.
Yeah, well, what kills me is all the pictures from NASA. You never see a satellite.
Well, you see one picture of Earth all the time.
Yeah, I mean, there's never anything floating around. It's always perfect. And, you know, I was curious the other day. I was thinking about energy and how energy seems to go away. You know, the law of conservation of energy, I actually looked it up. And I thought, now, wait a minute. Okay, so you've got a tree, and it starts out as a seed, which is very little energy, and it grows into this giant tree, and it lives, and it grows, and it supports things, and then it dies, and we burn it up for firewood, and the tree is gone, but the heat dissipates, so how is the tree's energy still here? It didn't make any sense to me. Now, I'm not a scientist, and maybe on the atomic level that makes sense. But, you know, it's another physical law that doesn't make any sense if you just think it through your head. And I thought, you know, life seems to create energy.
Yeah.
I mean,
well, we're also viewing this from a materialist viewpoint when we're talking about conservation of energy. I mean, the second law of thermodynamics, which basically says that that's predicated on the concept of an ever-expanding universe, which is dissipating. So energy spreads further and further out, hence it dissipates. Well, that's materially observed science, but it doesn't answer other questions of what happens in non-locality, where you have atomic structures that can literally jump without any visible, they're there one moment, they're somewhere else the next. That goes into the quantum. And when you begin to look at that, you realize that the energy hasn't dissipated. It's just simply jumped somewhere else as quickly as quicker than you could blink. So we're not even dealing with, again, linearity.
Mm-hmm.
We're dealing with refinements and understanding of time and space. I want to throw this out because I said I was going to do this. I found this great quote today. It was on Twitter. It's from a friend of mine on Twitter. He goes under esoteric esoteric exposal. And the quote is, time and space aren't conditions in which we live, but modes by which we think. Isn't that interesting?
Mm-hmm.
Time and space are how we conceptualize what's around us. Now, you can look at that two different ways, because when I put the quote up, I posed it two different ways. But I see that as those are materials we work with. Most people see those as limitations we live by.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, time is fluid and...
Very fluid.
And that's, I think time is an energy field that we've enveloped our entire matrix in. It surrounds everything, I think. And I've been pulled out of time a couple of times that another person was there with me. It was a few years ago. It was actually Christmas night. And my husband and I were exhausted. We had people and kids here. And we were cleaning up in the kitchen. And I was wiping a counter. And he had just walked out the back door and it bangs. And I turned around and he was back in the kitchen with a glass in his hand where he'd poured himself a Pepsi. And we both just stood there and I said, how did you get there? And he said, I don't know. I just went out the back door. I mean, we've had things like that happen. I mean, we were tired, but we were sober and basically happy and just bam. Time shifts or changes. And, you know, were we taken out of time? Did we do this ourselves? Was it a time slip? Who knows?
I call those time slips, and I've experienced them. I've actually experienced watching time go backwards in a couple of occasions.
And
that's actually happened in a group of people where other people observed it as experienced it as well. You can experience a time shift that divides, and my listeners have heard this story before, so I won't bore them with all the details. But basically what happens is somehow you slice the reality in half and one side goes one way and the other side goes the other way. And for that brief period of time, however brief it is, this particular incident lasted 40 minutes. I mean, it was like being on acid. I mean, literally, you feel, when you're done with it, you feel time sick because you have to reorient yourself back. You know, but abduction survivors talk about this all the time. We know that there's something that happens when you step into the field of an abduction where your time stream is interrupted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So,
it's happened, I think, three different times to us. Mm-hmm. I think back to creating our environment, I think the first thing people need to do is recognize their own thoughts. And that's so hard for many people to do. Because like I said, we have all these apps running in the foreground, things that we just automatically do, our mind programs. And are those even conscious choices for your programs? But examining thought is really important, especially with all the AI stuff going on. I mean, I have thoughts that pop into my head that I know are not mine. I know they're not. And I just discard them. I kind of laugh to myself and go on. But, people need to begin to create their own mind before they can create things outside themselves. I know that sounds weird. Everyone thinks they do create their own thoughts, but not necessarily. You have to create your thoughts consciously and not just let them go wherever they want to go.
Well, most of what passes for thought in the average person, and I count myself with this because I catch myself doing it, are the random thoughts you have that just move in and out because we're going about things in a certain state during the course of the day, and you become very task-oriented. Again, you get very literal, very linear, and you're just boom, 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 moving down the line. That's not the place where you create at. Most people do not create in a space of linearity and routine. They create it outside of linearity in a place where they go into alpha state or even a little lower towards theta, where you're closer to dream state. That's actually where we begin to create.
Yeah, and I've noticed the tendency to not only short attention spans, but people always being ahead of themselves. Mm. You're not about what you're doing. You're thinking about the next thing you're going to do.
Yes. Yeah.
So you're never actually in the moment. And I tell people to use what I call the tree exercise. It's kind of interesting. You can use anything you want to, but most people have a tree around. So that makes it simple. It's just look at the tree. Really look at it. And think of everything you can think of to describe the tree. You know, it's tall or it's short, it's green or the leaves are brown. And then when you've thought of everything, just look at it and let your mind quiet. And if your mind wants to go off, go back and describe the tree again. But it helps get focused and helps empty the mind, because we need to be able to do that when we're not in meditation. We need to be able to just stop and go into whatever level we want to be in at that point without having to sit down and go through the ritual of meditation.
Yeah, meditation. Yeah, meditation was basically a mechanism to get you into something that you should be able to access. I don't formally meditate the way most people think. I do. But I can sit down, and because years ago I did meditation from the time I was about 16, I have the ability now to just drop right into it. A couple of breaths and remembering to be here right now in this moment and shut down all of the thoughts that are running, because there's a bit stream running in the background. You push the program back into the background. You let it run back there. And the foreground program becomes the singularity, which is the now.
Mm-hmm.
Most people never, ever in their lives do that, much less cultivate the ability to do it on demand. And it's important.
Well, yeah. All the distractions now are to make sure no one can do it.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, make sure. I mean, click, 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 click from thing to thing to thing to thing to thing to thing. And the attention spans are about like that of a goldfish, which I think are about 3 seconds. And if
that's a good metaphor.
Yeah, I mean, you have to get control of your own head. You know, people say, oh, well, what can I do? What can I do? You know, how do I change this? Well, the first step is to get control of yourself. Not go out there. Out there isn't the answer. In here is the answer. You know, find the quiet point. Be in the moment. Consider your intentions. Again, what do you pay attention to? You know, do you want that political system? If you do, pay attention to it. If you don't, stop creating it. Because every thought we have adds energy to what we're thinking about and influences that field. I mean, even if I'm thinking about doing a show with you, it affects the energy field between us. You may not recognize it, but it would, and vice versa. Every time you think about anything, it affects that energy field because there's an energy field for everything, absolutely everything. You have an energy field between you and your kitchen sink. And once you are able to tune into those energy fields, you can do some amazing things. I mean, I know most people want to be more clairvoyant and more psychic. They say, how can I, you know, see more? How can I experience more? How can I know what's coming? Well, pay attention and be one-on-one and in the moment and learn to connect with whatever you're thinking about, or choose not to connect and don't think about it.
One of the things that's going on now, and what's different in the time that you and I grew up in, is that the speed of life has stepped up considerably. 35, 40 years ago, we did not have Wi-Fi. We did not have cell phone towers. We did not have all of this electromagnetic energy around us. A considerable amount of energy, even in your own home. And I mean, look, I'm trying to mitigate it all the time. That's all you can do because everywhere you go, it's there. On top of that, we have interfaced ourselves with these machines, much like the one we're communicating on right now, with clock cycles that are running at a speed you can't even consciously calculate. We're talking nanoseconds. We're talking time slicing on a level that's so finite. But it's speeding us up. And yet at the same time, it's distracting us because the human brain was not intended to run at a constant speed like this. So at the very moment when technology is unleashed and we have all of these creative potentials before us, we're being crippled by the very technology that should be empowering us because of choices we've made about the back planes and the energetic system that we put into effect. We collectively did that. I didn't sign off on the standards for Wi-Fi. I know there's other standards out there. I didn't push back from it either. Collectively, we've built this machine that we're now running on. And it is time slicing our attention spans. It's throwing more and more and more apps at us. It's creating all of these cycles of da-da-da-da-da-da, do this, do this, do that, when you didn't get that done, instead of slowing down.
Well, you know, the thing is, I think our controllers, whatever you want to call them, knew we were almost to the point where we could create and said, uh-oh, they need to create now. So we need to invent something that takes their attention away. Let them create on the internet. Then they won't seek the internal creative ability.
Well, they crippled us with the internet. Whereas the internet should have been for our use, they've now made it so much of a part of our lives that we are no longer able to function without it.
Oh, you're going out. Try again.
Okay.
It's back. Okay.
Okay. I think it came through on my side. It probably blurred out on your side for a minute there. I heard something in the background. So what I was saying was basically the internet was weaponized. Mm-hmm. It wasn't necessarily supposed to work this way. It's interesting because the personal computer came directly out of the same groups of think tanks that gave us the Aquarian Revolution of the 1960s. Almost the same people. When you go back and you study the history of technology and you find people like Stuart Brand, who published the Whole Earth Catalog and then turned around and started the first online bulletin board service called the Well in San Francisco. It's not an accident. These were natural outgrowths of technology at a time when consciousness was beginning to spike up. And yeah, there was a lot of subterfuge from intelligence agencies and a lot of interference, a lot of black ops. But a lot of that was real, and a lot of it got cut off, just like, you know, the revolution of the 60s got truncated by overuse of LSD and all of the other things that happened that turned it into such a nightmare. But this is what happens. All of the things that we have at our disposal as creative tools have been weaponized by these infernal, I call them the cabal, the overseers. I mean, who are they? What are they? Well, you know, there's layers and layers of mask to peel back there as well.
Oh, I agree. Well, and, you know, now that the internet, the alternative news is becoming more popular, people are becoming more aware, what do they introduce? Here come the androids. Everyone can have a sex bot. Who needs a mate?
Yes.
You know, the newest distraction, virtual reality. All the new toys are there to divert again. So
transhumanism, artificial intelligence.
Yeah, absolutely. The artificial intelligence is, on a daily basis, is a little scary. I mean, you know, I bought one of those Amazon Echoes because I wanted to know what the hell it could do and what it couldn't do. Mine's unplugged most of the time, but it's kind of interesting. And, you know, they're collecting everything. And I agree that perhaps we're being going to be coaxed into another matrix that's completely controlled.
Absolutely. Yep.
Yeah.
We're talking about that on here all the time.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think
data collection and aggregation there's no human way to possibly even make sense of the amount of data that's being collected just through the NSA data mining center in Utah, much less Google, Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, Yahoo, all of them. They're just piling data up like crazy. And yeah, I have one of those devices too. I have an Amazon Tap, a little round speaker thing. The only difference is it's not on all the time.
Yeah.
But it still wants all your information. It wants to know every friggin' thing in the world about you. And the more you feed it, the more it gives you back. It's like, tell me this and I'll give you that. It's a transaction. So, I can get up in the morning and all it needs to know is my zip code, and it will tell me the weather and in great detail.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also geolocating me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
And what the hell is wrong with walking outside in the morning, putting your face in the wind and figuring out what the time, temperature, and state of humidity is in the air anyway? You know, and then when we do that, I've done it. I've picked up my phone and pulled up the weather app and went, this is insane. There's a door right there. I can walk outside, you know.
But it goes back to the fact that we're biologically programmed to be lazy.
Sure.
And we were biologically programmed to do the least amount we can so that we don't starve to death, blah, 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 blah. It's like whoever programmed us left some of the really lousy stuff in there that they should have taken out and added more lousy stuff. So we kind of have to work against our own biology, I think. You know,
Yeah, I think we're working against the biology the way it was programmed.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you know, clearly an infant child has this period of time where they're, for all intents and purposes, not even capable of moving around. Children grow rather rapidly once that first year is over. It's amazing how fast they develop. And their natural skills tend towards survival. You know, you watch I have grandchildren. I've watched my grandson. He's not afraid of much, but he's very, very careful about falling because he understands that that's going to hurt.
Mm-hmm.
But he moves around and he's perfectly capable of walking into the kitchen and asking for food or water or whatever he needs at the time. But we do have this long development cycle. But we have a longer development cycle because we've hobbled ourselves with this concept that we're children, then we're adolescents, then we're young adults, And now we've got a group of, we've got a whole generation of people. I call them snowflakes. A lot of people call them, you know, the millennials. They don't appear they're going to grow up much before maybe 40 or 45 at this point. And they have all the excuses why they can't. Because they can't figure out who they are. They don't know what sex they are. They went to college and they're $180,000 in debt. And they never studied anything to earn the money to pay that debt back. And they're living in mom's basement. And life really sucks. And it's all our fault.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. And I don't know. You know, my kids were right on the line for the millennial thing. And they didn't catch that, thank goodness. But it's very interesting. I mean, I raised our kids. I was odd even before odd was in. And I raised our kids that I taught them they could do anything. They could walk through a wall. They had that ability. They could do anything. And it was interesting, you know, a few times during my son's athletic career, he actually did defy physics because he didn't know he couldn't. And it was very, very interesting. But, you know, I'm to that point where I think when we truly believe something is possible, I mean, truly believe it, not just think it, it becomes possible for us. And I think that's a goal. At least it is for me. I mean, I've seen time be manipulated. So if you, we know it can be manipulated.
I know time's not absolute.
Yeah. I mean, and now the question is, can we manipulate it? Probably.
I will go a step further. I would say that we are time. We are basically time lords. And what we've done, I just had an extensive conversation last night with somebody about this. We have synchronized ourselves to certain patterns and rhythms that are biological, really. Now, they are rooted in the earth, the sun, the sky, the moon, all of that. But on a finer level, what we've done is we've created a coordinated, it's kind of like a dance that we do with time between each other. And we are time. We are chronologically anchored into this concept of time. And yet, you know that inside yourself, depending on what you've engaged yourself to, it can seem like 1,000 years until you get something done. Or if you really enjoy it, time goes by like that.
Well, what I'm saying is I think we can consciously manipulate time.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you know, on purpose, say, you know, I don't want to wait an hour. I want 6 o'clock to be here now. I think we're capable of that. We just don't know that we're capable of that. We don't know it because we haven't done it yet. You know, there's that. I'm sure you've been through it. Well, you start so young, maybe not. There's that huge reality blast that happens when you realize that you've actually been abducted. Mm-hmm. Or I know it happened to me when I had my scars from my surgery all disappear on my stomach overnight. You know, you look and something just goes wham, and reality hits, and there's a huge soul and psychological change that happens at that point that you can't really describe until you've been through it. And I know I went through a similar thing when I realized that I knew that reality around me wasn't solid and that these glasses were appearing and not appearing. And I know you've had stuff appear and disappear as well. But now that I know that it's possible, I find things tend to do it a lot. And I find that really interesting. And, you know, the next question is, how can I make it happen? You know, I think we need to be questioning our abilities, especially those of us who have already kind of started down this path and say, you know, what can we do consciously? Can we break through the early programs of, no, that's imaginary. You can't do that. And actually do interesting things.
And I think this goes into dream time, which is really what we're talking about. It's the shamanic kind of thing where there is a suspension of normal time. When you go into dream time, when you, I've had objects that I saw in my sleep. And right now it's like really small, but those objects have shown up in the real world. And when they show up, somewhere here I've got a necklace that I bought. Hold on. This showed up in a dream, and then when I was on vacation, it showed up in the real world.
Oh, neat. I love that.
The mirror thing is kind of an extra added thing. Did you see that?
Yeah, that's amazing. It's beautiful.
That was a scene from a dream. My wife and I were up in the Poconos and stopped at a... It was kind of a place where you would buy, like, oils and candles and things like that. It's a little roadside place. And we're walking around, and all of a sudden I walked over to this one case, and I saw this, and it was a scene from a dream, because what I dreamed was I saw the sky open with that exact same color scheme.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. That's really amazing.
And I stood there and I looked at it and I finally said, so how much is that? And I was stunned. It was like, the guy only wanted 10 bucks for the thing. I was like, I'll totally take that. I mean, it's a big piece of jewelry for me as a guy to wear. But I, you know, that was something that materialized out of dream time. Now, it's a small thing, but it's not the first time that that's happened. There have been objects. And when I find an object now, I have in the back of me here, you can see in the, I don't know if you can see this or not, there's a tree behind me. It's a ficus tree. It's 7 foot tall. And it has a Zen garden around it. So in the Zen garden are pieces of quartz, different crystals, things I find in nature that have meaning to me. And usually they have an energy to them. And sometimes they are things that I've either dreamed or visualized as part of just stopping for a couple of minutes. A lot of times I get visions when I just do that meditation break. So, on one level, you take something like the little amulet here. It's a small thing, but it's a way that we get a sense that we are materializing things into our reality. And the reason I revere that and hold on to it is because of the fact that it's a frozen piece of my dream time.
Right, right. Yeah, because I haven't had it trans... I've had dreams of things that were going to happen, but they were scenes. Mm-hmm. Like, our life. The first thing that ever came to me was a dog collar appeared on my dresser one morning. I'd never seen it before, and I have nothing on my dresser but a candle. And there's this pink dog collar.
Yeah.
Just appeared from nowhere. And that kind of started the realization that things are fluid. You know, the center does not hold, to use an old quote. Yep. Yeah. And I think so many people have these experiences happening, but they don't trust themselves. That's an issue as well. They think, oh, I forgot, or... you know, well, that must have been that way before, or they don't want to deal with the fact that these things could be happening because things like that are imaginary. Their programming takes back over and sort of accepting what's actually happening around them. I mean, have you noticed that with a lot of people as well?
I don't notice it with a lot of people. I think most people don't trust themselves enough to allow for that. You know, here's what happens. People have these strange little anomalous things that happen, you know, and if you're close to people or if they may tell you this is kind of an anecdote, like a ha-ha moment, but they don't allow themselves to believe that that could actually happen. So an object shows up, and it shows up out of the blue, and you go through the mind tricks to tell yourself that has a logical explanation, meaning the operating system in the background has allowed that to happen, so it has a linear cause and effect means of happening. Now you've just removed all the mystery and all the magic away from it. I've had things that disappeared, and they disappeared for a long time and showed up in places they couldn't have possibly been.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, me too. It's very interesting. And sometimes it's something that you really need, and it's just not there anymore.
Yeah, and so I'll tell you something. Yeah, at least one occasion, it was money. And it was money I needed at a moment. It wasn't a lot of money. But, you know, if you could believe for $5, why not 500 and go from there?
Yeah. Well, I had a period of time, gosh, it was 4 or 5 years ago, where I had a $20 bill that kept reoccurring in my purse. And I thought this was great. It was like, okay, now there's another. It was like daily. You know, as soon as the old one was spent, a new 20 would show up. And I was really stupid. And I finally decided to question it, and then it stopped. Of course.
Yes. Yep.
But that was great fun. Probably 10 or 15 different times, it just appeared in my wallet where there had been no money. And it was very convenient. And I wish I knew how the hell I did it, because I'd sure do it again with hundreds. But
the part of you that knows how you did it is still there. It just wants to know it won't be challenged when it does it again. Because it'll do something improbable, and it won't be a $20 bill anymore. It might be, you don't know what it's going to do. Because here's a trippy idea. And this is one I've been playing with for a while, and I've talked about this on the show a little bit. So, we're not really one being. Our physicality here is an expression. It's a localized version of us, because we actually exist on multiple planes, multiple dimensions. The many worlds theory. And I can tell you that I know that's true. And some other people have talked about this. In fact, Emily's talked about this on the show, of encountering a version of herself.
I've done that, yeah.
Yeah. Now, that version of yourself, in that brief moment where you experience it, that's you showing up to tell you that there's other yous working out there. It's like if you could take yourself, and maybe the other self knows things that you don't know in this realm, and it's had experiences, and its realm has different rules than yours, all of a sudden, now you're actually talking about magic, but you're talking about something that's occurring on dimensional levels outside of normal space-time. Just like that quote, space and time are tools for us to use.
Right. Yeah, I've had that happen. I've gone into myself in different lives during the dream state.
Mm-hmm.
In different realities. And one was really horrible. It was in New York City. And I don't know what had happened, but I was taking care of a whole bunch of children in an attic and going down and begging food for them. And it was really weird. And then another one, I appeared for just a little while and watched myself at a funeral. Mm-hmm. And we get these glimpses, and you know it's you when you say there's no doubt.
There's no doubt, no.
Yeah, there's absolutely no doubt. Yeah, that it's a dream or no. You know it's an alternate you. So, I mean, I always joke about I want to go be the me that has plenty of money and, you know, the day before payday, I'm ready to be the other me. But we do exist on different planes. And I mean, is there one of us? Is our soul in an upper dimension, looking down on all of these and gathering experiences. It's kind of an interesting thought as to how it works.
Well, part of the reason why most people can't grasp this concept is because, again, they've been told they're this one being. They don't, because of certain things I've experienced, and because I see it as an advantage now. It sounded like madness when I was younger, but I've experienced things outside of space and time, outside of the stream of normality, where I can accept that very easily. So the concept of me meeting an alternative version of myself, that isn't strange to me at all. But it is strange to most people, and it's probably strange to talk about. But if you can get past that, you now have a concept you can work with. Because we're still thinking linear. Is that other occurrence of me higher? And the answer is no, it's a stacked reality. It's all probabilities. Each version is experiencing variations of an experience that is part of, you could call it oversoul or higher self. This doesn't go into like theology or anything. It's just that something outside of us that's actually is bigger than us in a way. It encompasses us. We're part of it. It is us. But at the same time, it is the totality of all of our experiences in and out of time, in and out of this life, next life, other life, all the probabilities.
Yeah. And that's the other question is, are there really billions of other worlds for every choice we make? Somehow I don't know. I have a little trouble with that one.
Every decision you make, and this does go into quantum physics, it does go into even the Heisenberg thing. Every decision you make creates another node off of the, if you took a straight line and you begin with the first decision you ever made, and you continue to make decisions, you are building experientially kind of this tree-type thing where you branch, you diverge, you make this decision. That decision impacts vibrationally other things. You and I made a decision to do a show tonight. In doing that, we set time aside. So that's time that we didn't do something else in this present realm. But it was a commitment we made. It's a decision. It impacts other things. Other people will see this show. They'll stop. They'll watch it. They'll hear us talking about these concepts. We're impacting a reality stream by virtue of the fact of what we're doing right now. So I can't help but think that that's just simply a probability generator. Whether it's billions or millions or a few hundred doesn't really matter. But you are throwing off an aspect of yourself that goes in a certain direction, but there were other decisions you didn't make that I believe still get made. I believe the alternative universe sits there and the door swings both ways.
That's interesting. I mean, time is certainly not my expertise area at all. And I find it interesting, and it's a little intimidating. It flows in odd ways, and when I think of time, I think of, I have no idea what it's going to do. And I try to keep it open, I guess, so that I don't use programming to try to lock it down into the mundane, if that makes sense.
No, I mean, time is something that we use. I mean, on one level, there's a beginning, a middle, and all the events in between. There's something they call the end. We seem to equate that to physical death. But I don't happen to believe in death that way, because here again, I've talked to people that have been long departed from this earth. You know, I don't believe in the separation of the soul from the body as simply being the end of it all.
No.
That said, I don't have a God concept that's rooted in a religious structure either. In fact, if anything, I probably spent the first 40 years of my life getting rid of all that, because that was programming that was really hard to get rid of. And some of it still sits there. You know, I did a show for years called The Threshing Floor, which was very Christian based. But it was actually me slowly pulling myself out of that whole thing by getting to the point where I went, you know, this just doesn't work for me anymore. So I don't look at it theologically, but I look at it more or less as a way to deconstruct the stream around us in a way that's useful. If we're eternal, we have the ability to transcend this dimension. We exist in other dimensions, both simultaneously, before, after. If there's no time, then everything's simultaneous. What's the old saying? Time's simply the way that was designed to keep everything from happening at once.
Yeah. Well,
because it would be a mess, right? Would you really want to live all your life at once? I mean, you know, no. We have a sequence of events here.
Yeah, and it gives us room to grow and have more experiences. But, you know, I wonder, too, sometimes, is that propaganda as well? Is that just another lie to want us to keep coming back? You know?
Well, there's I mean, you know, I'm doing a series with a man named Shamil Asher.
I love that series, yes.
And in that series, that's what we talk about. Because we all have this sense that somehow, it's kind of like the abduction scenario. You're taken, you're used, you're wiped, you drop back in, you're taken, you're used, you're wiped, you drop back in. You have these vestiges of memories of things. You have certain physical characteristics. Things about you change. Weird shit goes on. But you don't have full memory of it. And the thing that's been taken from us the most as a race of people is our collective memory of who we are and the sense of history that we lost, because we know that as we are right now, Dana, we sense that we're at this consciousness wave. It's coming up. It's been escalating for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the exact point at which they like to come in and smash the civilization back down. You get near extinction level events, you know, planetary collisions, floods, huge fires, civilizations crashing down.
But can they do it unless we create it? If they can't get us to create it, will it happen?
That's the important point. We've always done it to ourselves. We are the weapon that's wielded against us. There is no enemy greater than humanity against humanity. They know that. They know that if tomorrow morning they walked out of their ships, or they landed circled over our cities and holographed in, they'd know right away that the game was over, because at that point, although there would be the shock, there's now an external enemy. And Ronald Reagan used to say all the time, I can't help but imagine what would happen if people knew about an extraterrestrial existence that sat out there. Humanity would unite. They've never needed to do that.
Yeah, well, I mean, they've left themselves so many ways to get us to destroy ourselves.
Yes.
I mean, convince us of Planet X. You know, convince us of nuclear war. Convince us of an alien. Look at all the programs that are programming. I mean, look how many of our movies, our TV shows, our books are about the destruction of the human race. And more TV shows are survival, you know. This little group that survived the cataclysm. So, yeah, they're going to be able to pick, but hopefully they've spread themselves too thin and people just aren't going to buy it. One can hope.
We can hope. Actually, we can do more than hope. We can begin to create. And the way we do that is, that's really what we're talking about here. We need to create it first on our own local levels. We need to begin to unwrap our own potential. If it's materializing this sky scene and finding an object at a roadside market, or if it's creating a space around you that's a creative space, that's a peaceful space, if it's the 10 or 15 minutes you take three times a day to stop everything, slow down your pace, slow down your breath, slow down your system, and be focused on the now, and allow dream time to come in and drop something into you, which is you talking to you, then you can begin to create. You create on a micro level, macro level, and then you zoom out to global.
Well, and I think the other thing people need to create is they need to create relationships with other people.
Yeah.
And,
yes.
You know, every time, I'm not talking romantic relationships. I'm just talking kind relationships. I mean, if you have met someone that you liked, find that energy field, contact them, connect, put down the damn phone, and go connect with a real person, because that's going to be our strength as well, is the real life connections and relationships that we have feed us back, and we need those. We really do. And I have created those in my life, and I'm very, very grateful and glad that I did. And I think you have too. And it's, I see a lot of people that are very alone on the internet or appear to be.
Yes.
It's very sad.
Part of the deception of the internet is that we have to find people who are like us. We have to begin to be able to not only tolerate, but actually celebrate the differences between us, because that's where you learn and that's where you grow.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not looking for 100% agreement. I'm not looking for, quote, like-minded people. I actually quite enjoy when people take me on certain things when it's done in a right spirit. And I enjoy the give and take that comes of exchanging ideas and different views. I mean, you said earlier, the time thing's not really your deal. It kind of is my deal. That's kind of what I've worked with. And I mean, I have journals that go back to when I was a teenager. I've been writing about this stuff my whole life. I'm completely intrigued by it. It's like the big mystery that I got to solve this time. But see, there's somebody out there who's trying to solve the mystery of manifestation, or how to deal with like inner hurt. I mean, there are people who are dealing with all kinds of things, and I need to plug in and engage that as well, because that's a component of me too. You know, so when I'm talking to different people, they have different needs. They may not plug in on my dominant theme. I may need to plug in on theirs, because I'm going to learn something about them doing that.
So we've
got to start looking for people who are just like us. And we've got to celebrate people who are different.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I agree. And so many people have gifts that seem to be coming out. I mean, I hear about them all the time. I have a friend who's suddenly become a precog, and she's just amazed, and I think it's wonderful. But I think as more people become aware of maybe gifts that were being dormant or have been dormant, they're going to be looking online for answers. So I think it's important for other people to come. I mean, that's why I'm back tonight, because I know that there are people. That's why I said, hey, Randy, we need to do a show.
Yeah.
Because there are people who are experiencing more and looking for answers, and hopefully conversations like this can give them some.
And let's talk a little bit for a moment about the website. And I don't know, you know, what you've been doing with it. I know there were some people there and some interaction going on. But tell people a little bit about the website and how that fits into what you've been doing.
Well, I created Stellarpax about 3 years ago, and I couldn't find a safe place. I couldn't find a safe place to blog that wasn't corporate, that wasn't controlled, that somebody wasn't going to claim ownership if they wanted to of my pictures, of my videos, of my blogging. Yeah. And that's really what I created it for, is for a safe space. I run it. I don't get into anything private. People can go there. They can write down their experiences. They can use it for a backup for their experiences. They can interact with other people who've had similar experiences. At the moment, it's, like I say, it's almost a safe storage and a safe place to be able to write down what's happening to you. And you don't, I don't need your real name. I don't need anything. And the only rule is be kind. That's our only rule, is be kind. And that makes it really, really simple. And it's stellarpax.com, and Stellarpax means universal peace in Latin. So it's there for people that want to use it. And my email is there, I think, on the front page. If they need anything, they can email me. And that's where we're at.
And you created that space sort of out of both your own need, but also realizing that there was a whole group of people out there who aren't served by the social media structure. The social media structures we have right now in the public. And, I mean, I use Facebook and I use YouTube, but we are exiting out of those things to some degree this year.
Yeah.
And moving towards, you and I have talked a little bit about possibly merging some things, even pulling Stellarpax into our universe so that our listeners can have use of that space, which is something they can do today. They don't need to wait for that.
No, they don't. And there's no charge. There's no, obligation. There's just a place to put things and converse with other people.
Now, what things can people put there?
They can make blog posts, they can store pictures, they can store videos.
Cool.
Pretty much anything, it goes on your profile. Mm-hmm. There's a million profile questions you can answer or not answer. It can be as inclusive as you want it to be. If all you want is, your email and a username, that's fine. And if you want to add everything in the world about your experiences and blog posts and pictures, and it's ready.
Do people tend to forge relationships there in your experience? Or maybe you don't know.
Yeah, I think they have. I think they definitely have. And it's set up so that, you can search through the blog posts for gray aliens or time travel or whatever it is, and maybe find other experiences that are like yours.
Yeah.
And read about them. And I've also got it set so that there's no copying off the site. So people can't steal your stuff as well. They can't right click. I mean, they can take a page shot, but they can't
right
click and take your information away. So I've tried to really protect the users, and I protected them from what I didn't like when I used different sites that I found just too invasive and too difficult. So,
I know for what I want to do next, I need to get out of the troll culture that is so dominant, especially on YouTube. It's so abusive. Emily just said something to me. I mean, other people know that Emily came on as a co-host about, I guess, 4 or 5 months ago. And I gave her the basic rundown on, how things are. And she kind of knew that anyway. And, she's taken a fair number of lumps, and she's also gotten a lot of compliments. But I think the one thing we both realized is how abusive it is out there in terms of we've never charged. I've been doing this. I've been on the Internet since 2003. I have been doing radio shows on the internet the same amount of time. I have given everything away. And one of the things about giving it away is that people seem to think that somehow they're entitled to abuse you.
Yeah.
And I, you know, for the longest time, I didn't understand that. It still baffles me. I understand it more now. But I think the only way you give value to something is when you put it in a safe place and you protect it.
Oh, I agree. Yeah.
I've asked a lot of people to come on this show, including yourself, who have shared pretty deep and dark details of their lives. I don't think they deserve to be abused. And so, more and more, and you're going to see it this year, the free ride on the internet's going away anyway. Facebook is going to a monetizing system. YouTube is asking you now that if you want ads taken off your videos, you have to pay them. It's all going to get very commercial. America is heading into a different economic period. It won't be a depression. It will be kind of, let's just say, the corporatocracy is about to rise because of the leadership in this country. I'm not judging that. I don't care. That's just the trend that I see right now.
Yeah, and it's, you know, people like you and me have been able to support or been willing to support free services for a long, long time, but we have to live as well.
That's right.
And the amount of time it takes, you know, I spent, I mean, I'm not a web developer. It took hundreds of...
You are now.
Yeah. It took hundreds of hours. Oh, I'm echoing. Okay, it took hundreds of hours to get Stellarpax to where it needed to be. Mm. You know, and fortunately, I have a husband that pays the bills, or it wouldn't be. If I was single, I'd be out of luck. There would be no such thing. So, I think a lot of the websites that are out there, you have to look at their base, and their base is, you know, this. You can make a free website almost anywhere. But the base is corporate, and if you look at the terms of service, you realize that you're screwed. But people don't look at that. And so, yeah, Facebook is, I dislike it with a passion. I have a very, very limited presence there. I tried. I just, it feels dirty and nasty to me.
Yeah. I don't disagree with you at all, Dana.
I can't do it. So I get on every 2 or 3 weeks and see if anyone has messaged me. That's about it. But I applaud that, again, the getting off of YouTube as well. It's becoming more and more corporate. And I think a lot of the younger generation are willing to pay for it, where I don't think a lot of the older generation will. They're going to go to their specific areas like what you're making and instead spend their dollars towards that.
Well, again, you know, I think the time has come to place a value on what we do and just let that be what it's going to be. To create something means you take a risk. And I didn't have an audience at all when I began this show. I simply started putting it out there. Never expected it to go to where it went. It's still not a huge deal, but, you know, there's thousands of people out there that hear these shows and see them. And so I guess we built something. And, you know, that's creation. I mean, you know, really, you created a website out of nothing, including not knowing how to build a website. I had modest talents in doing radio. I never did TV, but I did radio. And a little bit of tech skills in terms of being able to put a website together. But I never set out to do this on any level beyond just trying to get a few messages out. So, you know, we're talking about creation, about manifesting things. And really, you know, now we're sitting here talking about it and look what we've done.
Yeah, it's been quite a ride, but, you know, something keeps driving, I think, both of us to get the information out and to influence that stream of consciousness.
Yeah,
it's almost a drive.
Part of it is just to find other people. You know, we're now at the point where I think we know we're not going to hit the mass. I'm not Pollyannish enough to think that we're going to awaken mass consciousness. I think that will trigger off of what we do. The level that humanity wakes up is going to be equal to how much we wake up and we push that effort out. Everything moves off of a minority, not a majority.
Oh, yeah.
No, that's the fallacy of politics. The majority rules. No, it doesn't. The truth of the matter is that what rules is like maybe 1 to 0.5% of most people. And those are the people I call the ones that count.
Yeah, and eventually the energy fields, those people's energy fields will influence others and it will just continue on and on and on. You know, it's like consciously affecting the energy of the store and the people when you walk in, you know, and spreading kindness. It just spreads. So hopefully what you and I and others with actual good intent are doing will spread. You know, the problem's been separating the people who are paid agents from the people who are sincere. And
I think we're going a long way towards that now, because the playground has been in the social media. And even before Facebook and everything, we had bulletin boards. I mean, I don't know about you. I did Above Top Secret and all these other places, the David Icke forums and things like that. And I mean, that had a time and a place, but it feels kind of over now.
Yeah. But, you know, I think some of those places are where people get started.
Yeah. Project Camelot, Project Avalon. You know, in the day they served a purpose, and I connected with people there. So I can't completely dismiss all that. Those people created something, too.
I
think some of them squandered what they built, and that's a lesson learned as well. You know, that we basically be very good stewards of what we create.
Exactly. Well, you know, I think everybody's at a different growth stage and a different understanding stage and, you know, David Icke for beginners kind of a thing. I mean, that's kind of where you start out with the easy theories and move up from there. I created Stellarpax to be a safe place. I created what I couldn't find for myself to give to others. So hopefully it'll, you know, we have about 550 members now. We grow each month and it just keeps increasing. I mean, I haven't done really any advertising. You've got a banner up and a couple of other places there's a banner up, but it's just been word of mouth. So anyone is welcome. I mean, come join us and write down what's happening and talk to other people who are having similar stuff happen.
Anything else you want to bring up or talk about before we head on out into the moonlight?
I don't think so, but thank you for having me back. You know, you're the only one I've done any interviews with, and I've been asked an awful lot, but my comfort zone just hasn't been there with other people, and maybe I should change that, but it just feels right. And
so let me ask you this. The first time you came on, you were UFO Chick at UFOChick.com, right?
Yeah.
So is the UFO Chick site gone, or do you still maintain that?
It switches you over to Stellarpax.
Okay, got it. Because I love that. I mean, I was so intrigued by UFO Chick, and I didn't know you at the time. And that was a very interesting first interview that we did. We'll have to dig up and put back out, I think, because I'm not sure if it's still up or not. Is it still there?
I don't know. Well, you know, I never listened to it again. I didn't. I don't even know what's on there, but have at it, Randy. Have at it.
Yeah, unfortunately, I get forced to listen to my own shows sometimes. But we're our worst critics. We're also our best creators, and I think that's what you leave us with tonight, Dana, is that we have this ability to create, and we need to begin to pivot off of that. So,
yes.
Having said that, I thank you, Dana Donlon, for coming on to the show. And people can find you at stellarpax.com.
Yeah.
And you can join in there. That is part of our community as well. And we look forward to bringing the communities together in a more meaningful way in the near future. I see that as something very positive that we can do. So stellarpax.com. Those who are watching this, offplanetradio.com. The link for Stellarpax is on the front page of offplanetradio.com. I'm Randy Moggins. This is Off Planet Radio. Truth is out there. It is inside of you.